Hello, everyone. Welcome again to Mass United Insurance's Line and Length. It's the cricket program where we look at the sport not only in the region, but internationally as well. I'm Barry Wilkinson. So great to have you wherever you're watching on Scene TV, on Sportsmax, or anywhere around the region. With me is Andrew Seeley. It has become a bit of a cliche now by saying what a week it has been in West Indies cricket. But no, it really has been a very big week. This man, Otis Gibson, the coach since 2010, reportedly fired on a Sunday, but confirmed by separating mutually on Tuesday by the West Indies Cricket Board.
Well, certainly it's a long story, and I believe it will continue. Otis Gibson, disappointed, I'm sure he is, but some people are not disappointed and some people are not surprised. In fact, tonight we hear more.
That's right. Ian Bishop, he is on our program. Of course, the former West Indies and Trinidad and Tobago fast bowler, now doing a fantastic job as a commentator. He is going to chime in big time and give his thoughts on why Otis Gibson might have left at this time. Also, we're going to hear from Roland Butcher, former England player who is going to be on the program, especially looking not only at Otis Gibson, but why India might have played so poorly in English conditions. We've got lots to discuss. When we come back, stay tuned. Mass United Insurance, Line and Length, about to begin.
Across the Caribbean, more people are placing their trust in Massey United Insurance for the protection of the things that are important to them, their homes, businesses, and their prized possessions. That's because Massey United Insurance offers excellent general insurance coverage to help you manage whatever life sends your way. Our cadre of well-reputed agencies and trained insurance professionals are always ready to provide you with sound advice and prompt service. Choose the security and sound strength that is Massey United Insurance.
I live cool, I live fresh, I live life without the stress. Every day I feel my best, I live cool with Climacool. Feel the energy, feel the breeze, I feel like doing as I please. Relaxation comes with ease, I live cool with Climacool.
Live cool with Climacool and feel the freshness of a breeze in a bottle. Climacool is trusted the world over and gives that easy, breezy Caribbean feel to all.
Every day I feel my best, I live cool.
Welcome back to Mass United Insurance's Line and Length. As promised, let's go to St. George's, Grenada, and speak with Ian Bishop, a man, of course, who's been traveling the world doing cricket commentary, former West Indies player, doing a fantastic job. Ian, very good to see you as usual there in St. George's, Grenada. First questions first, I want to talk about Otis Gibson. Was it a big surprise for you when you heard the news that himself and the board were separating?
Yeah, I have to admit that I wasn't expecting it at this point in time, so close to a series, so close to the World Cup as well. So I'm not sure why it transpired and why it transpired at the time that it did. So whether the New Zealand loss in the Test series broke the was the straw that broke the camel's back, I don't, but I'm a bit surprised.
You look at alternatives immediately, like you said, India tour coming up, you have the South African tour, and like you said, the World Cup is something that they should be preparing for all now in terms of looking at a squad. Who would you identify as an immediate replacement?
I don't know that I can identify anyone as a long-term replacement. I mean, those sorts of issues, you really have to see who's available. And out of those available, what do those candidates bring to the table? And that really can only come about by discussion, deep discussion with the candidates available. I'm hearing talk about Mickey Arthur. You know, people are talking about Phil Simmons as well, who's currently coaching Ireland. So, look, a lot of it is going to be speculation. I suppose the ingredients that a coach needs is to come in and to be able to deal with the different cultures that exist in the West Indies setup. Bring on, have that ability to bring on a lot of youngsters. This is not what I would call a mature team. There are some mature players, but most of this team is going to be a team that needs to be developed. So, you know, the coach is going to have a lot of skills, and I don't know that I can identify one person at the moment.
Let's spend a little bit of time talking about the record of Otis Gibson. First of all, were you impressed with how, what he did, what he achieved, his win-loss ratio? Did it inspire you any? How do you view his tenure as West Indies coach?
He obviously, that World T20 is obviously the standout of Otis Gibson's career. It's a huge achievement given the West Indies' lack of silverware at that level for many years. I think he didn't do as well in Test match cricket when you look at the debacle that happened in India, that happened in New Zealand in the last 6 months, then lost to New Zealand here. So Test cricket left a lot to be desired, and particularly against the teams that are ranked above the West Indies. The one-day cricket really hasn't gone anywhere, and you're hearing a lot of talk about him not getting on with individuals, but I don't pay too much attention to that because players want to have their own way, and sometimes they don't deal well with measures that are required of them. So I think the record of Otis is an inspiring one, but then, you know, he won that World T20, so I still am a bit surprised.
Now, you know, you look at the West Indies team now, and you see that they have Stuart Williams and Kirtley Ambrose, who are bowling consultant and, a stand-in or interim coach, if you want to call it that. How do you view perhaps them being the men to take the West Indies forward? Do you think those two are capable enough, or would you strongly recommend that Richard Pybus, who's the director of cricket, would you strongly recommend that he brings in someone else?
You're asking some tough questions today, Barry.
Indeed I am. I'm not going to let you get away, Bish.
What are Kirtley's skills? Kirtley, by his own confession, can tend to motivate guys, bowlers, to go out there and do their best. Is he technically equipped to be able to work with the technical issues of a bowler? I don't know that that is something that Kirtley calls his strength. Some guys make good assistant coaches, some guys make good bowling coaches, but some people have said about Otis Gibson, being a head coach is a different story. And so, again, I think there needs to be more detailed analysis. There needs to be more in-depth discussion with those players and with the available candidates, whoever they are, before we can just say, elevate Stuart Williams. What is his level of expertise? Being an assistant coach and being a head coach is a big difference. There's a huge gulf in terms of knowledge and organizational skills required.
All right, we got to ease Otis a little bit. I want to talk to you now about the CPL, Limecol Caribbean Premier League, the second edition just completed. What were your impressions? You covered the entire series again this year.
The cricket was entertaining. Some of the standards of the batting were better. I think when you look at the number of centuries scored, some of the bowling was better as well. So I think from a cricketing perspective, there was a slight improvement, the catching and all of that. I still want to see more of the batsmen, whether that be local batsmen, playing smarter cricket. When I look at how the Amazon Warriors got through the tournament and then some of their mid-order hadn't quite done what they were supposed to do, the Talawas outside of Gale, sometimes Chadwick Walton, didn't really click as a batting unit. The Tridents, not a confident batting team generally. So I think there's some work to be done from a batting perspective. The Hawksbills and the Zooks need a lot of work. But there are enough pluses. The people came out in St. Kitts, the people came out in Port of Spain, they came out in Barbados. The timings have to be better. And the big thing for me about the tournament itself, that the officiating needs to be stronger. The rules need to be the rules and to be made clear so we don't have what we have in the final with the rain curtailing and not everyone being sure what the rules were. So I think those things need to be very clear and the officials need to be very strong and come out and say what.
So you don't subscribe to what happened then with the Tridents winning by virtue of Duckworth-Lewis? Do you think that that was an inaccurate reflection of who was the strongest team really in the competition?
I think, and people are going to have other views, but all round, from an all-round perspective, a good batting team and a good enough bowling team, I think the Amazon Warriors were probably a better all-round unit. But I think the Tridents, particularly from a bowling point of view, found their mojo on the St. Kitts leg of the Lima Call CPL, and they became a very, very strong bowling unit. If I had to look across the entire tournament, I think the Amazon Warriors, when Sunil Narine played, looked the better all-round, but the Tridents bowling certainly, as it came towards the last part of the CPL, stood head and shoulders above everything else, not to mention Pollard's captaincy. Pollard, easily the best captain of the CPL.
I was just going to ask you, your good friend Desmond Haynes, who is the manager, or the mentor rather, of the Tridents team, he has publicly said that he thinks Pollard is a future West Indies captain in the shorter version of the game. My question to you, Ian Bishop, is looking at how well he played in that first ODI, West Indies versus Bangladesh, and looking at how what you said in terms of his captaincy, do you subscribe to that view that he could be captain of the West Indies one-day team sometime soon?
Well, sometime down the road. What I would ask of Kyron Pollard, and I'm sure Pollard is smart enough to know, is that he needs to be more consistent in his batting performance, just round off his personality just a little more, because he can have a little bit of a temper, Kyron, at times, so he has to mold that, and those around him have to mold that. I still term him a very impressive personality. He's aggressive. That's what I like about his captaincy. He's aggressive. He doesn't mind setting field in different situations, setting field, take wickets. That is what has been lacking at times with Dinesh Ramdin, who's getting better at it, at times with Darren Sammy, and at times even Chris Gayle's captaincy. So Pollard is aggressive. He likes to rotate his bowlers. He goes a lot by instinct at times, which I think is a good blend. But in order to be able to send it, I want to see him be more consistent, particularly with the bat, because a leader has to lead the performance. He leads by his personality as well, Pollard. He's a strong personality. Think down the road, but he needs to be more consistent.
All right, Ian Bishop, I'm going to let you get away and get on the golf course. I know you're itching to do that. Thanks so much again for joining us on Mass United Insurance's Line and Length. Keep up the fantastic work, and we look forward to seeing you very soon.
Across the Caribbean, more people are placing their trust in Massey United Insurance for the protection of the things that are important to them, their homes, businesses, and their prized possessions. That's because Massey United Insurance offers excellent general insurance coverage to help you manage whatever life sends your way. Our cadre of well-reputed agencies and trained insurance professionals are always ready to provide you with sound advice and prompt service. Choose the security and sound strength that is Massey United Insurance.
I live cool, I live fresh, I live life without the stress. Every day I feel my best, I live cool with Lima Call. Feel the energy, feel the breeze, I feel like doing as I please. Relaxation comes with ease, I live cool with Lima Call.
Live cool with Lima Call and feel the freshness of a breeze in a bottle. Lima Call is trusted the world over and gives that easy, breezy Caribbean feel to all.
Every day I feel my best, I live cool with Lima Call.
We're back on the program, Mass United Insurance's Line and Length. With us now is Roland Butcher, former England and Barbados player. Good to have you on the program. Of course, Andrew Seeley is with us. Otis Gibson continues to be a hot topic. You might have just heard the thoughts there of Ian Bishop. Let's get started on that, because it's still the running story, so to speak. Were you surprised by Otis Gibson's sudden exit, because it happened within the space of 24 to 36 hours?
Barry, yes, I was surprised, but I wasn't surprised as well. All the rumors we heard recently...
Is it a conundrum?
Yeah, it is a conundrum. I'll tell you why. A couple of weeks ago, I had heard somebody told me that, well, this is not going to be with the team. He's going to be out of it. I couldn't actually believe what was happening. But as it got closer and closer, I could understand exactly what happened.
Okay.
Because basically, they're playing Bangladesh. They will beat Bangladesh. There's no doubt about that. To get rid of him after they've won a series, it would not go down too well. So I could see the rush to get to do it before the series started.
And there is some rationale behind that thought.
There's some interesting thinking there from Roland Butcher. Not normally expected, Roland, but certainly you've gone overboard today. Now tell us a bit. After New Zealand, we obviously had lost, and there was the discussion once again about the future of Otis Gibson. But then it died down. What do you think rekindled this? I mean, we had not heard anything, I think, for a couple of months. We just heard that Bangladesh was coming. It's basically almost an irrelevant series at this stage. But and then 2 days before, we had the back and forth with the board saying, no, it's not true, but every other newspaper, and including the Line 11 network, having the real story.
Well, I can't believe that they got rid of him simply because they lost that test match in Barbados against New Zealand. Yeah. I cannot believe if that is the case.
You tend to think that was the second chance he had, because losing to India so badly was poor. Losing to New Zealand in New Zealand the way they did after such a promising fight back was also very poor. So you tend to believe that he was on a probation that was not said. And what happened against New Zealand was the straw that broke the camel's back.
If I may intercede now quickly. Yeah. But Gibson's contract was renewed in February.
It was.
I'm unprecedented, Roland.
It was renewed to be renewed. 2013. It was renewed after the Cricket World Cup that he won, the trophy that he won last year.
Okay.
So it actually was supposed to end in 2016 in October. So what was not surprising was the fact that it was renewed when it was, because he struck while the iron was hot. He won the World Cup for the West Indies 2012 in October, and it was renewed, of course, as it was constitutionally due to be, as you would say, in February of 2013.
Barry, I'm going to defend Otis Gibson here. Mm-hmm. And I'll say, Otis Gibson was planning for the New Zealand tour, right? Suddenly, they threw this tour to India in this span, right? Okay. Which disrupted the preparations, okay? Mm-hmm. That, if that was not enough, suddenly they threw in a tour to Florida before the India tour, right? Mm. So the two things that disrupted the whole preparations. So he goes off to India, must get beat. They've had no preparation. They did not prepare in Florida either. And while they're in India, you remember the players turned up in New Zealand just before the test match.
They played
a game with about six players. Mm-hmm. That was the only lead-up game before the test match. And on top of that, Otis Gibson had to go off to Perth with two players to be tested, mm-hmm. right? So I expected, with that preparation, that he would lose both series. And I don't see how they could hold that against him. The series against New Zealand here, obviously the changing of the team in the final one and the losing, that is something that they could question. But those other two series should not come into it at all.
Mm-hmm. But it's more of the same though, Roland, isn't it? We have seen and heard this all before. We've been through the saga of Sir Vivian Richards, Clive Lloyd, Roger Harper, Gus Logie, and the list goes on and on. Then we've gone to Australia and got Bennett King and John Dyson. I know they're saying that they're going to bring Mickey Arthur, who the Australians fired for incompetence. But Richard Pybus, who has indicated that perhaps we don't want an overseas coach, but he's fired the local coach, so we wait to see what will happen next. But the saga continues in terms of West Indies cricket.
Well, it certainly does. And you said the name Mickey Arthur has been bandied about.
Yep.
Mickey Arthur may be a very good coach, but I am wondering if Mickey Arthur in Australia with more resources, better players, and was not able to cut it there, whether he's going to come to the Caribbean with less quality players, less resources, and he's going to make a significant difference.
A name was called by Ian Bishop that I did not think of, really, and that was Phil Simmons, because I know that the Irish love him. I'm not quite sure, and I speak to correction, but I'm not quite sure about the status of his contract as coach with Ireland.
Recently renewed within the last year.
But I'm sure if they really want him they can get him. Is he a good man?
Well, I really don't know much of his credentials. I mean, obviously he has coached Ireland for a number of years. The question is, they will have to decide whether he has got the requisite skills to bring this West Indian team forward. Whoever comes into this job is going to find it very, very difficult. There's no doubt about it. I mean, Otis Gibson brought a lot of experience and not just as a bowling coach.
And he brought some level of fitness and success. I mean, you cannot discount and you cannot throw away that win in the World Cup in 2012. And also, he stood up to the senior players, which might have been his undoing and his perhaps the relationship he might have had in the end with them.
Well, yes, I think all of those things came to bear. And sometimes you can win the battle but lose the war. Yeah. And that may have been the situation where he actually won that battle but ultimately lost the war. But I think he has moved certain parts of the game on in the West Indies because, as you said, he's tried to bring the discipline and the training into it. Whether it's been wholly embraced is another matter. Whoever comes in is going to have to wrestle with that whole idea.
All right, we won the war on time here because we're going to take a break when we come back. England and India, a battle that was not to be for the Indians because they simply did not turn up in those last couple of test matches. When we come back on Mass United Insurance's Line to Length.
Across the Caribbean, more people are placing their trust in Massey United Insurance for the protection of the things that are important to them, their homes, businesses, and their prized possessions. That's because Massey United Insurance offers excellent general insurance coverage to help you manage whatever life sends your way. Our cadre of well-reputed agencies and trained insurance professionals are always ready to provide you with sound advice and prompt service. Choose the security and sound strength that is Massey United Insurance.
I live cool, I live fresh, I live life without the stress. Every day I feel my best, I live cool with Limacol. Feel the energy, feel the breeze, I feel like doing as I please. Relaxation comes with ease, I live cool with Limacol.
Live cool with Limacol and feel the freshness of a breeze in a bottle. Limacol is trusted the world over and gives that easy, breezy Caribbean feel to all.
Every day I feel my best, I live cool with Limacol.
We're back for the final segment on Mass United Insurance's Line and Length. Roland Butcher continues to stay with us. Former England player, of course, he is Barbadian. Something like Chris Jordan, to tell the truth. And speaking of Chris Jordan, he's not former. Very, very present. Because he made his presence known and felt in that last test. Let's talk India, England for a little while. How good was it for you to sit down and watch Chris Jordan, a Barbadian by birth, schooled at the Commonwealth School, playing for England now, much like yourself, although you didn't go to Commonwealth, but much like yourself, who would have played in 1980-81 playing for England. He helped shatter the Indians. Your thoughts?
Well, he certainly did. I was very pleased for Christopher because, as you know, the last couple of years, it hasn't been easy for him. The problems he had at Surrey, and eventually had to leave Surrey to go to Sussex to resurrect his career. So I was very pleased that he was able to get the opportunity first to represent England, and now he's starting to develop as a good test match bowler, and to have bowled India out in this test match, and he's now starting to look the sort of bowler that they thought he would be for a long time.
And generally, Roland, the England team looked very positive. There had been much discussion re the future of Alistair Cook, but a couple of drop catches probably saved his international career, and following that, then at the end of the series, it was Mahendra Singh Dhoni and Duncan Fletcher that looked to be on the chopping block.
Well, yeah, certainly Alistair Cook was under a lot of pressure. As we know, his batting wasn't that good. But he's come good and he got some runs, and I think that's helped the team to be a lot more confident. And more importantly, suddenly James Anderson came to life and started the ball, and their game really took off from there. India, as you said, won the first test match. They were right in the series. But sadly, England came back with some good batting and bowling performances. And as you know, if conditions are helpful, Anderson is a handful.
There's a great level of respect for Mahendra Singh Dhoni out there. But you get the feeling now that after he's lost this series, that he might be thinking of giving up one of the captaincies in Test 50 over or T20. Do you share that view?
Yes, I do. And the reason I share that view is that, I mean, he has carried that team for so long. I mean, to be captain, to be wicketkeeper, to be expected to make a lot of runs, which he's been doing, I mean, phenomenal. I don't think there's anybody else that I know around the game that could have actually done what he's done for so long. So I think it's probably time now for him to shed some of that responsibility and maybe just concentrate on batting and wicketkeeping.
Well, certainly the Indians are off to Australia, and already famed former Australian fast bowler Glenn McGrath has suggested it could be a 4-0 down under. You know, the Aussies always start the psychological games and wars. Your thoughts on India and Australia having just played in England?
I think India will play a lot better in Australia.
Why do you think so?
I think so because the pitches will be more conducive for batting. They'll be a little bit more paced on the ball. And people like Kohli, as you know, who's had a nightmare in England with a moving ball, I mean, he will flourish in Australia. People like Pujara, etc. So I feel India will do a lot better in Australia than they did in England.
Really? That's interesting that you say that, Roland. Of course, we'll be around on Mass United Insurance's line of life to discuss it. But the Australians, in fact, and the captain, Michael Clark, says he's looking forward to have India in their backyard.
Well, he is because, I mean, he doesn't like going to India. He knows what's happened to India, to Australian
in
teams
India.
Over the
right.
years in India. So they've always had a pretty rough time. So naturally, he wants to get them in Australia. He wants to play at Perth. He wants to play every test match at Perth. But I think India will do a lot better in Australia, definitely.
Overall, were you happy with how the England team were able to fight back? After that first test, even the second test, Cook was under a lot of pressure, like you correctly said. Were you happy, though, with how the Robsons, the Ballots, the Bells came along? Because they, too, their plays were also under a lot of scrutiny, especially since they found no one really properly to replace Trott.
Yes, I mean, I think they recovered well. I mean, whether they were playing against a stronger side, they may not have recovered that well. Against this India side in England, I think it was possible for them to do that. As you said, Robson came in and eventually he got some runs. Balance has been a real plus for them. Coming in at number three, he's got runs. Roots got some runs. Bell got a score too. And the wicketkeeper, Butler, who's come in from Matt Prayer, he also has got a couple of scores. But I think they're bowling. There's still a problem with the bowling. I don't think the bowling is that good. Apart from Stuart Broad, you've got Jordan still trying to find his way. They're having to rely on Ali as a spin bowler. And, you know, they're average bowlers. So I think they've still got some work to do in the bowling department.
All right. Wonderful stuff. Thank you so much, Roland Butcher, former England player, giving his take on England versus India. And Andrew Steele, of course, chiming in. We want to continue hearing from you. Continue to send your emails to cricket@lineandlength.net. Or you can also follow us on Twitter at Line Length. We wait to see what will happen, who will be the next coach of West Indies cricket. As we speak, of course, we're speaking on the eve of the second ODI. Congrats to that great fight back for the West Indies in that first one with Dinesh Ramdin and, of course, Kyron Pollard. We look forward to seeing some more of that consistency shining through. That's it then for the program. Until next week, things are happening so fast and furious. Next week, we might be looking for a new host of Mass United. You never know. Bye-bye for now.